Well, it is 6:30, so I'm going to go ahead and get us started. Do we have anybody with us on Zoom tonight? I know Susan and Matt both couldn't be here.
Barbara.
Hey, Barbara, how are you?
Hey.
Well, then I will get us started. Let's start with a time of prayer first. Most gracious God, we thank you for the day that you've given us, Lord, and we thank you that you've given us time this evening to meet together and to continue to discuss what it means to be a faithful disciple of Christ, Lord. You've given us time to discuss that this faith is a journey. You call us to be faithful each and every day and to grow closer to the life that you have given to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, and to grow closer to the person that you've created and called us to be. So God, we just pray that you would be with us in the course of the next few minutes, Lord, that we would be challenged to be more faithful to you, Lord, that we would understand this life that you have given us in a new way, Lord, and that we would leave this place a new and different people. God, we pray for our church, Lord, especially those who are going through difficult times. Lord, we pray for Patrick Coughlin, Lord, and Lillian Ridgeway, especially, Lord, that you would just be with both of them, Lord, to be with Karen as well. God, we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. So we're finishing Pilgrim Letters tonight, and we've read the last principle, which is on eternal judgment, and then also I can't remember if he calls it a conclusion or what he calls
conclusion.
It, which is about going on toward perfection. So I want us to start with principle 6, eternal judgment, and I'm going to just read the Q&A that he did for that. So the question is, what is God's final judgment of those who are baptized and united with Christ? And the answer is, I trust that in Jesus Christ, God has spoken both a life-giving yes and a death-dealing no to sin and evil. But I also trust that in his death on the cross, Jesus bore the no for all, so that in his resurrection, all that remains is God's yes. The Holy Spirit assures me that I am a child of God and an heir of God's promised salvation. So there's an awful lot going on in that. Was it one sentence? Two sentences. Did we have any reaction maybe to that? Or if not, we can just go to the actual letter. Okay, well, what was our... was there anything maybe that stood out in the letter, Principle 6, about eternal judgment?
Well, on page 63, I like the statements that he wrote. It's part of John Edwards' sermons, God's wrath is not the end of the story. The last word is mercy. For only God's love can spare us from the torments of hell. And in the end of that same paragraph, yet God has mercifully extended favor to all who will only repent and turn to Christ for help. So he, you know, starts out with the sinners in the hands of the angry God, but he talks about that God offers mercy if we will only ask.
Yeah.
I had a Sunday school teacher, adult Sunday school class, that put before the class, do you think if, and kind of picture Jonathan Edwards' illustration of a person that's been cast into the lake of fire and they're like sailing through the air towards the lake of fire, getting ready to go in, but they haven't gone in yet, can they still repent at that point and be saved? Or is it too late? And we all just sat there because we had never thought about it and didn't know what to answer.
And what was his answer? Did he give you an answer?
I think he believed that, yes, you still could.
Yeah. Was that when you were Methodist, at the Methodist church?
It was at the Methodist church, but he was a Baptist.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because Methodist, I mean, I would probably agree with that. Like, I mean, I think you always have the opportunity to repent. You know, I don't think it matters, you know, at what point you do it, as long as you repent and like authentically repent. But I know like Methodists are huge about that. Like, you know, that there's always the opportunity for repentance and that you should never stand in the way of repentance. And you should always give people that opportunity. But yeah.
In group share, there's a spot in one of the videos. And of course, I think his last name is Hill. He's a Black minister. And he said that so many people paint a picture of God standing on the gangplank of a ship with a board in his hand saying, get off, you can't come home here. He says, but no, God is reaching with every hand that he has, and he's willing to grab you by the hair and, you know, your arm or your leg. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Yeah.
But this man tells it in such an interesting way. It's very interesting to me. Yeah. E.B. Hill, I think it's his name. He was a good minister. He's gone on to heaven now, but.
Well, I guess that brings up the question, does anyone go to hell then? Or is it like, there universal salvation? The people that believe Jesus came to save everyone and they leave out the part of everyone that repents and comes to him. They just think everyone, which kind of makes a lot of things pointless.
No, yeah.
I couldn't quite tell. In some parts, it seemed almost like this guy was starting to go in that direction, but then he didn't.
Yeah. Well, to be honest with you, knowing Dr. Freeman, so mid-20th century, there was this theological movement called the Neo-Orthodoxy, and it's probably the most well-known theologian was Karl Barth. And so Dr. Freeman's really influenced by this guy, and he references him several times, Jim McClendon, who's Baptist. But Jim McClendon, I believe, was a student of Karl Barth. So Karl Barth gets accused of being a universalist a lot. But if you read Karl Barth, he's also very adamant that he was not a universalist. But, you know, it's like I don't know that he ever explained it in a way that was satisfying to people that disagreed with what they took him to mean. So, but yeah, I think it's kind of like, to your point, Barth especially gets accused of it a lot because it's like he treads that line and then he goes almost the whole way, but then like, you know, doesn't make the full commitment, but then like he's already taken the train all the way there. So like the logical, you know, which is all to say, like, that's unfortunately a pretty common like theological thing in that time period, and has worked its way down at this point now for probably 50 or 60 years.
Well, on page 64, that big long paragraph, he starts out, is there really a place that is forever beyond the reach of God's love? And then he goes on to talk about the theologian Jim McClendon, and he talks about picture thinking. And he said, at the end of that page, he says, these pictures warn us not to neglect the great gift of salvation in Christ, and they show us that our actions in response have ultimate consequences. So I think that says not everybody goes to heaven.
That's the paragraph where it seemed like he was going in the direction like you're saying, but then at the end, he puts in the last sentence that's like, but, you know.
It gets really confusing. Theologians like Barth and then McClendon too, both really get interested in time and like what, you know, we experience time linearly, but God is like eternal. So, you know, by nature of being eternal, there is no beginning and end. And they start like, theologians can go in some interesting directions anyway, but when you start adding time into that, they go some places that are quite bizarre. And, you know, I can see, I think Dr. Freeman's reined in a little bit more than McClendon was, but yeah, no, they do. The picture thinking, I struggle to know what to make of that, maybe. And maybe it's because I'm just not a visual person, and it's hard for me to identify with that. But I mean, I thought it was an interesting idea, but I don't quite know that I understand exactly what it means, or what he means by it. I do think he makes a good point about, you know, that eternal judgment is not only what happens at the end, like last things, it's also about things that last. Like, I thought that was a pretty, I think sometimes we don't think about that. Like when we think about salvation and judgment, it's, you know, God's, you know, he doesn't just create a new heaven, he also creates a new earth, and that, you know, he seems interested in having people experience this life that he came to give them in Jesus Christ in the here and now too. And that, you know, we can't just be concerned or fearful about what might happen to us in eternity. But, you know, we also need to be attentive to how our actions in the here and now also affect other people and you know, live on, you know, have lasting effects.
And the parable of the 10 maidens is very interesting too.
Yeah. I thought to go another two pages on 66, when he starts talking about the sheep and the goats, I thought that was like just a really, I mean, to me, I found that pretty moving. I'm just going to read a few sentences starting in pretty much the middle of the page. It says, his judgment is based on the way these sheep and goats behave when they could not begin to imagine it counting. Their actions when they thought no one was watching are precisely what counts, because they show who they really are. Their uncalculating love, their aimless faithfulness, or their lack thereof, reveals their destinies. Yet the parable suggests an even bigger mistake to assume that eternal judgment is all about us. It's really not about us at all. It's about Jesus, crucified, risen, and returning, Son of God and Son of Man. And then it goes on to end that paragraph, well, I guess before he starts quoting Philippians. The deeds that unconsciously display our true characters ultimately matter, not because they are about us, but because they reflect the character of the one, as the ancient hymn attests. And then he goes on to quote Paul. And like, I think that kind of stood out to me, because we're looking at a passage from 2 Corinthians this Sunday. And Paul's talking about like how he always carries around in his body, the death of Jesus, so that others might experience the life of Jesus. And I think kind of in the context of 2 Corinthians, what that means is that, you know, he was faithful to serve those people and to sacrifice for himself, you know, and to embrace suffering and poverty, really, so that they might have life. Like, you know, that's what it meant for him to carry around the body of Christ, or the death of Christ in his body. And I think that's kind of what, you know, he's hinting at here, is that, you know, if we receive life in Jesus Christ, if we've truly been transformed, it changes how we act all the time. It changes how we interact with others, how we treat others. Like in every interaction, you know, it's the life that we have in Christ and how we know Christ calls us to live. That should be what guides our action. Well, anything else in this chapter?
Well, 67, I just thought, you know, I'll have to do a lot of rereading.
Yeah.
The vision of judgment in the Synoptic Gospels is futuristic, and the picture of judgment in John is already realized. I thought that was interesting, just because I haven't studied enough to have known that that was something that scholars would have figured out long before me.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting too. Anything else?
I like the discussion on 68 and 69 of love, that things are eternal because they last. And Paul states, love never ends. And then in the quote in the very middle, love must be eternal. It is what God is. On the last analysis, then, love is life. Love never fails, and life never fails so long as there is love. We talk about in grief share that even though the person you have lost is not physically there, their love is still there.
Yeah.
Their love is what keeps us united with them.
Yeah.
And there's one image of that somebody wrote that says, I have not left you. I have gone into another room. We are still connected. We just can't see each other.
Yeah.
You know, so that's something that I find very interesting.
Yep. Bridget mentioned this last night when we were talking about it, about like the eternal judgment chapter, that you made the comment that you thought it was interesting that a chapter about eternal love, a judgment, he spent so much time talking about love that like you weren't anticipating that, right?
No.
I thought that was pretty interesting too.
And the final quote by Pope Francis, the name of God is mercy. This is on page 70. Remember your baptism and be thankful that your life is surrounded by God's boundless love, unbounded even by time, because love never ends.
Yeah. Yeah, there's another Catholic theologian, or I don't know if you call him a theologian, but a priest, Henry Nouwen, who passed away. But he talks about, he uses the term beloved a lot, like, you know, Jesus calls us the beloved, and that, you know, that to be faithful is to recognize the great gift that's given to us, and that we are God's beloved, and that everyone is God's beloved. And that, you know, he does a lot with like the prodigal son story. And, but it isn't, you know, and it's, I guess it's an interesting chapter to me in that, you know, he's, I don't think he was like super fond of the Jonathan Edwards, you know, I mean, I think he was kind of pushing back against sinners in the hand of an angry God about maybe that goes too far in one direction. So, but he starts with this, you know, sinners in the hand of angry God, and then works his way to like, you know, talking mostly about love. And it's just this very, very interesting chapter in my opinion, in like the progression. And then like, you know, it's all about eternal judgment. I just thought it was, there's a lot going on. And I'm not quite sure I know what to make of it.
Well, just know for an 11-year-old, I mean, we're adults discussing this.
Yeah, might be a stretch.
Like for an 11-year-old, they're probably, I don't know, maybe he's quite sharp and deep thinking, but it seems like a lot.
Yeah, I can see that. Okay, well, if there's nothing else in there, what about in the conclusion, going on to perfection?
Well, on the very first page, I was struck by his comment that these principles are not so much fences designed to restrain our faith. Instead, they are like guideposts meant to give us direction in our Christian journey.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought that was an interesting image too.
He just marked same page 73. The basic religious formation many young people get today comes down to thinking that God is nice and that we should be nice too, which is, there's nothing wrong with that, but I mean, there's difficult teachings in the Bible too. And sometimes you have to be taught things that maybe you don't want to hear, that you don't always get to.
Well, I think he's quoting, scholar named Christian Smith that wrote a book called Soul Searching. It's actually two scholars, but that So have you ever heard the term moral therapeutic deism? So it's a term, it's probably 10 or 15 years old at this point. But like sociologists that study religion and like what people actually believe, like it's this term, I can't remember who it was that coined it. It might've been Christian Smith, that like the most prevalent belief among teenagers and then probably people between 20 and 30 about like Christianity was that, you know, if you were a good person, like God wanted you to be a good person. And if you were a good person, that was all that ultimately mattered, right? And like, so, you know, moral therapeutic deism is what they define that. And it is really interesting, you know, to your point too, Sarah, that one thing that I can't remember if it's Christian Smith or somebody that ended up writing a book with Christian Smith a little bit later on that studies like how we teach the faith to young people, but especially like theological education too, said that you think about, well, in high school, like what subjects, especially juniors and seniors, do we ask high schoolers or expect them to be able to learn, like calculus and physics and chemistry, stuff that's not simple by any stretch of the imagination, complicated stuff. And that, you know, we trust them to be able to figure that out and to struggle with it and to know they're going to struggle with it, but to learn it. But then, you know, like if you were to like take a survey of what the average high school Sunday school lesson is, like we've dumbed down the faith so much for young people, like, you know, probably part of the reason they don't know the faith is because we haven't challenged them in the way that they're accustomed to being challenged, that they're equipped to be challenged. And like, it's just boring, right? When I was a youth minister, especially, I always thought, you know, tried to be more intentional about throwing those big ideas out there and things that they struck. Cause like most kids want to talk about that anyway. You know, I mean, they like to debate and to go back and forth and yeah. I really liked on the bottom of 74, another one of those mid 20th century theologians, Emil Brunner, when he said the Swiss Reformed theologian Emil Brunner warned that the failure to go on was rooted in a deficient baptismal practice. He asked, what does the fact of having been baptized mean for a large number of contemporary people who do not know and do not even care to know whether they have been baptized? I thought that was a pretty interesting, you know, especially like in light of, you know, the other conversations we've had about how intentional, I mean, he even hints at it or talks about it more in this chapter, how intentional the early church was in their baptismal practices and the process that led up to it and the symbolism of it all and explaining that symbolism.
Well, I guess it was good that he, 75, about page 75, about three-fourths of the way down, he explains what seeking perfection means, which I know you talked a little bit about it as being a concept that was a John Wesley thing.
Yeah, it's like a Methodist thing. Yeah.
And but that he thought you could reach perfection in your human life?
Well, I think like, so perfection meaning...
Because this makes it seem like you reach perfection when you die, meet God.
Yeah, I think like perfection meaning that, you know, you're not perfect because obviously you sin, but that you could be so faithful as a disciple of Christ to live in the way Christ calls you to live, that at least in theory, perfection in this life was attainable and that you could completely turn away from the powers of sin and just seek the life, you know. Is this the chapter where he talks about how, like, how?
Well, he describes it as to seek perfection. So he doesn't say being perfect, but seeking perfection means being discontent with simply being who we happen to be as we are and asking who we could be if we realized our true nature in Christ's new creation.
Yeah.
So I guess he's just saying it, you don't just, you're not just stagnant.
Right.
In your faith.
Yeah. I don't know. I guess this is probably not a good explanation or one that will be satisfying. But like I think it's one of those things where like my Methodist friends would say, and I think like when they go through ordination, they have to say, yes, you know, we seek after, we intend to, I think he mentions it in here somewhere.
Yeah, I think he does, but I don't remember.
But there's some question they have to ask, like they push on towards perfection or something like that. And that like what John Wesley would say was that, you know, you could reach perfection, at least in theory, but that they would probably say you don't, you know? So it's one of the, like in theory, yes, but in reality, no. But if in reality, no, then how could it be yes in theory, I guess. It's one of those things that's always confused me. Yeah, so Methodist elders must still answer the question at ordination, are you going on to perfection? They must be prepared to respond, yes, by the grace of God. So yes, here, I think your characterization is more accurate than that. There's a big difference between going on to perfection and arriving at perfection. Well, what else?
Like the line at the top of page 76, where he says, faith is not a one-time experience, but a lifelong journey. And then at the end of that paragraph, he is quoting Sir John Oldcastle from 1413. The whole long name there. Every man dwelling on earth is a pilgrim, either towards bliss or else towards pain.
Yeah.
You know, if we don't connect with God and have that hope, you know, I thought about that word hope every time I saw it. And on page 77 at the top of the page, it says, living in hope and soaring on the wings of love. You know, I heard an incident just when I was going to get my hair cut earlier today, where this young man had asked this girl to marry him, and she was very excited, and they were planning their life, and they were getting ready to buy a house. They haven't gotten married, and they were planning to buy a house together, and she came home and found him dead from an overdose.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, you know, you would think that he had every reason to live, but if you're not connected with God, there's still pain there.
Yeah.
And there had to be some kind of pain to make him take that drug when he had everything right in front of him to live for. He chose to do something so destructive. And of course, not only ruined his life, but you know, she's got a lot in his family. Mm-hmm. You know, and we're all either working towards the bliss of heaven or the pain of separation from God, whether you call it hell or what you call it. But if you're separated from God, there's not peace, there's not happiness, there's not satisfaction. And at the top of page 77, starts at the bottom, Christians in their earthly pilgrimage are resident aliens yearning for home. They are exiles like the Jews in Babylon, refugees like Roman citizens displaced in North Africa. Christian pilgrims are homesick. Their hearts are heavy. They travel homeward, walking by faith, living in hope, and soaring on the wings of love. Johnny Erickson Tata has this little thing where she says that the earth cannot satisfy. It's like we have a homing device, and it's not working for earth, doesn't satisfy. That homing device is pinging for heaven.
Yeah.
And it won't be satisfied until we actually reach heaven.
Yeah, I really like that whole paragraph leading up to that too, about the idea of like pilgrimage and being pilgrims, and the church being this pilgrim community. And, you know, resident aliens is like a very biblical term, an Old Testament term that, you know, that even in Moses's day, you know, there's a people that weren't the Hebrew people that lived among the Hebrew people, and they were given this special designation that the Hebrew people were taught to teach them in a very, you know, to show hospitality and treat them in a special way.
I don't know where it is, but he mentions about that pilgrimage in, I think it's mostly across Spain.
Yeah.
I read a book written by a woman who did that pilgrimage.
Oh, really?
And she was probably in her 60s. And she wasn't in bad shape to begin with, but in preparation for it, she writes about how here in the States, she started walking because they wanted to cover so many miles in a day, you know, so that it didn't take them a year to do it.
Yeah.
So she started walking at home, you know, like 2 miles a day, and then upped it to 3 miles a day and so forth, so she could do the amount that they wanted. And breaking in shoes, because she had read about other people saying no matter how good a shape you're in and everything, how, you know, you'd get horrible places from your shoes from walking that much.
Yeah.
But it was really excellent. It was really excellent. And she wasn't Catholic. I think that's who was, it was St.
Yeah,
James
her.
Something.
Yeah.
Yeah. I forget the name of it, what they
the Camino.
Call it. Yeah, the way of something.
St. James.
St. James, yeah. But, and so it was interesting because I probably read that at least 10 years ago, how it had gotten down to where it was just a little handful of people that were doing it in a year, and how now it's up to, what do they say, 300,000 that sign up for it.
Yeah, but only 30,000 actually did it.
The
yeah.
End. They maybe just do a part of it. But that was kind of cool that I recognized what he was talking about.
Yeah. Well, any other thoughts?
He ends on the word hope.
Yeah.
At the top of page 81, let us not be ashamed that we are called and prepared by God to a final destination, a city whose builder and maker is God, a city not made with human hands. This is God's promise. This is our hope.
Yes.
So I see hope as not a questionable will it or won't it. I see it as that's my goal, you know.
And I guess Paul there would disagree with John Wesley, where he says at the bottom of page 80, the journey toward perfection will come to an end, like when you reach your eternal home.
Yeah.
The perfect has come and the partial will pass away. So
yeah.
You can't really reach that in this earthly life.
Well, I think that the thing that Paul teaches about what you want to do, you don't do,
yes.
And what you don't want to do, you somehow
do
end up doing. You know, we still have that struggle until the time that we get our new life and our new body.
Yeah, I think John Wesley was probably way more optimistic than Paul tended to be.
Maybe he just had an extremely good sense of self-control. But remember, it wasn't he the one whose mother prayed with her children an hour every day? I cannot imagine a house full. I read his biography or something, you know, that
He says Susanna Wesley, his mother, is who he owes.
Really?
It all to. Yes.
So see, I intentionally didn't. When I was in seminary, the Methodists were so into John Wesley, and it was like almost like cultish in
to
a
the
way.
Point that you didn't want
to the be. Point like I didn't want anything to be like I heard one more thing about John Wesley or one more thing about being strangely warmed or you know it's just like I can't stand it. You know, this is too much.
I mean, I only had two children and she had, I don't know, 10 or 11 or something. And supposedly she prayed an hour a day with her children.
Really?
I cannot even imagine. And, you know, she didn't have an automatic dishwasher or washing machine. You know, she had to do the labor, but she found that she made that time to pray with her children. So I guess if you had been prayed for that much every day, maybe you were much stronger.
There's a lot of responsibility that comes
in your self-control.
With that too. You can't let mom down for all those hours of prayer that she gave us every week.
That's right.
That's pretty interesting. I'd never heard that. I have to look that up.
Yeah. Well, the way it was told to me, and I think I heard it in a sermon, was that she prayed an hour with each child. Oh, I don't know how she could have done that.
That's
so
impossible.
I just kind of transposed it in my mind that she prayed with all of them together collectively for an hour. You know, I tried to read Bible stories for my children. Have prayers at night. There was no hour of prayer. Wow. That's pretty.
That is. Well, then, just thinking about this book overall, a question I was thinking about some this afternoon is that, like, you know, how does a book like this and some of the things that talk about challenge us to do things differently here to make, you know, disciples that are more faithful, that do recognize faith as this journey and it's this process and that we continually should grow in our faith and mature.
I think just the general idea of how baptism should be viewed as something monumental and child or an adult, whatever age you are when you're baptized in your life, not just something that takes a few minutes during the service and then that's it. I don't know. I think about how, because my granddaughter is getting ready on the 10th, I think, to have fifth grade graduation. Well, once upon a time, you only had graduation from high school, in the 12th grade. Now you graduate from preschool, they even wear little caps and gowns. You have graduation from kindergarten. Now she's having it from elementary school, then you have it from middle school. It's like so overdone, it's almost become
routine in a way.
Yeah. But still people make such a big deal of it, you know, with the ceremony, and then they're having a big party afterward and then a pool thing. And I just thought all of that, just because she's leaving the fifth grade for the sixth grade, yet a child's baptism is over in 5 minutes. And then maybe the family goes out to lunch, lunch or something.
Right. Absolutely, yeah.
But it's just like, wow, how have we gotten away from that not being such a special, special
day?
Yeah. And not just a day, but it should go on,
I think what's so interesting, too, is that, you know, it's not just a special, at least I think if you take him seriously, it's not just a special day for the individual, although it is. Like, it should be a special day in the life of the church, too, right? Because you're welcoming this new member into your body, this member that now you have responsibility to disciple and the member that hopefully will help strengthen your body in the years to come. I mean, it's... And I think that's like completely lost. I mean, you know, I think that was my main takeaway too, just the challenge of how we approach baptism and just how.
And the follow-up.
Yeah.
The continuing to nurture so that you keep growing in your faith. Yeah.
Because one of my friends is a minister at a bigger church in Greensboro, and when they did baby dedication, until I saw him do it this way, I'd always been kind of against baby dedication because it just felt a little bit too close, like infant baptism to be. But, you know, they have a huge sanctuary. So, I mean, it's, you know, three sections. But then it's so big that there's like a break kind of like halfway back where there's an aisle. And anyway, you know, so he'll actually take the baby from the parents and they go through this kind of like covenantal agreement, you know, where he asks questions and answers, et cetera. And the children's minister does the same thing. And then he takes the baby and then like we'll go around the sanctuary and like, you know, essentially talk to the child about this body that, you know, is making this decision that morning to support them and to disciple them and to be there for them and to teach them the faith. And then the way he always ends it is that, you know, when he's walking back up the aisle, he talks about how, you know, today I'll walk you back up the aisle, but it's in preparation for the day when, you know, after these people have prayed, who have prayed for you and who have taught you the faith and have brought you up, you'll make the decision to walk down this aisle for yourself. And I'm like, whoa, you know, like now I can completely understand why you would do something like that. But I mean, to me, it was just like one of the most like moving acts of worship and like this, like how does the, like it implicates the entire congregation, and he did such a good job of articulating how. It just seems so much more meaningful to me than, you know, the baby dedication that I had seen growing up on Mother's Day when there's four or five kids up there and it lasts 10 minutes for all of them. And that's about the extent of it, right?
I've been service before where they do that, where they take the...
Jay Anderson used to
the baby
really?
Do a lot more.
Walk up, you know, and down the aisles and just walk slowly and everybody could just kind of smile and say, oh, welcome little one to the church. And, you know, obviously if they're like a 3-month-old, they don't know what's happening. But if they're big enough to be upright and looking around, you know, it was always really nice.
Yeah. I have a very treasured photograph of Dave Anderson holding my little granddaughter.
Really?
And he walked around with her. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And see, that's incredibly meaningful to you, right?
Oh, it is. You know? It is. They were home on visit from Africa and we were going to have a baby dedication. I said, you got to bring her. It's got to be done. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, I have also witnessed many where it was just a collective, oh, here are all these babies and their parents have come and, you know, and they did address the church, but yeah, I think it's more meaningful when they speak to each child.
Oh, absolutely.
And each family individually.
Yeah. Well, any other ways that it challenges us maybe as a church to do things differently?
Well, it's challenged me, and I have to be very honest, the first chapter or so, I thought this is a very dry book and this is not very interesting. And I don't know if I want to keep doing this, but the more I read it, the more into it I got. And the more I was challenged that I needed to buckle down and study harder.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just being honest.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah.
I like getting together to discuss any book, really, that, you know, I care enough to read.
Yeah.
But I like the idea of having this.
Yeah. Well, if there's nothing else, then we'll look forward to next week then. So I've got a few copies of the Screwtape Letters if you don't have one. You have one. Okay. So I looked through it some this afternoon. Essentially, it's like this. It's letters. They're much shorter. So most of them, it's a 200-page book, and there's 31 letters, and then there's a pretty lengthy part at the end that it's not really a letter per se, but anyway, I was thinking that maybe, you know, if we just wanted to read, and do we think we could read 4 letters? So you're probably looking at 12 to 15 pages.
Yeah, and the font is very large.
Yeah, the font's very big. The only thing I'm thinking, you don't want to read too many letters because then it would be hard to discuss. Like if you're reading 6 or 7 a week,
mm-hmm.
you really can't spend much time on any.
Well, his writing is so rich and deep that I find myself having to not, it's not difficult, it's just rich. You know what I mean? Like I can read the same page a couple of times because I'm just, and Barbara, I know you love the book. just to absorb it all.
Yeah.
You know, and I'll read it again. Like, that was really good. I want to read that again. So, yeah. So I think four sounds good.
Okay.
And we can start with four if we decide we wanted to do more, we could.
Yeah, that's true. So then for next week, I guess if you want to read the preface, and then also the first four letters or so. So that would take us through page... I guess page 19 maybe is where letter four ends.
I mean, you can try that, but I think Sarah's right. There's so much in there, even though it's not very many pages, that I usually have to, I read the whole book through and then I went back and read it and took notes and yeah. You can try four and see how it goes.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes for next week. Yeah. I will say, let's see, I'll be here next week. And then the following week, but then I'm going to be gone for 2 weeks, for two Thursdays. So my suggestion would be that we continue, even if I'm not here, just know that somebody else will need to, I mean, I don't really think I lead the conversation by any stretch of the imagination. So so that's something to think about. We can try to settle on that maybe next week or something like that. But anyway, yeah, so we'll read the first four letters for next week. Well, I'll pray and then I hope you have a good rest of your evening.
Hey, Garrett.
Yes.
Did Lillian go home?
No. No, she's going to stay at the hospital through the weekend.
Okay.
And then they're going to actually move her to what used to be Woodview for a little while so she can get physical therapy and speech therapy and stuff like that.
Okay.
So they were going to move her tomorrow, but then decided that, you know, maybe that it would be good to have a few more days there. So she's doing a lot better. It's just, I think, a matter of getting her strength back up at her age. It's going to be a challenge. So, but yeah. So, well, let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the time you've given us tonight, Lord, to discuss, Lord, how we can be more faithful to you, Lord, how we can not only receive your salvation, but grow in it, Lord, and also live lives that help us share the good news of that salvation with others. Lord, we just pray that as a congregation, we would be intentional about growing as disciples, but also helping other disciples grow in their faith as well. Lord, that we would be intentional about discerning who you have created and called us to be and being faithful to be those people, Lord, in this place, that we might make much of the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. God, we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.